This is on page 20.
And I did mention to you last lesson that the reason why it's called a bomb calorimeter isn't because it's likely to explode, but just because of its resemblance to the bomb. You have a picture of one on your page 20, and there's a few, I guess, important things that are present. Remembering that this is an experimental way of determining the change in entropy. We looked at the tin can method, and the bomb is the other method. Use an insulated container. And we have one like this, well, ours is a little bit different. We have like a stirrer of some description. Drawn that, which one's the anode and which one's the cathode?
Anode's on the left.
And what charge does it have? Positive charge, so the long stick here indicates the positive, the short stick is the negative. And if you are prone to forgetting, I like to think, well, here for the positive sign, I've got two sticks, and if I added them together, they would end up with a longer stick than the negative sign, which is just a short stick by itself. Okay, so the positive terminal has the long stick, and yes, because this is electrolysis, our anode has the positive terminal. Anode. We're going to be adding electrical energy. You might remember Q equals IT. From FISA. Now, what we're going to use though is that our electrical energy, enthalpy, is equal to VIT. Here's where things get a little bit confusing. What we want to know then is what's the change in enthalpy per degree? We want to know the calibration factor. H over delta T. This is going to tell me how much energy is changed. What's the energy per degree? We don't want to just know the total energy, we want to know the energy per degree. So, our calibration factor then is a combination of these two together. We've got here a delta capital T, which is talking about the change in temperature. probability here, which is talking about time in seconds. Okay, so we have to be careful with our calculations, make sure we don't get our things mixed up. So our calibration factor there, we could also write that as VIT over T. Delta T. See how we can combine these two together. That's this relationship here. At the moment, I'm still only talking about calibrating the bomb calorimeter. So I put in a known quantity of water and I zap it for a known length of time with a known voltage or a known current there. And I measure the temperature change in the water. Once I have the calibration factor, then I can perform a chemical reaction in the bomb. Once I'm just doing a chemical reaction in the bomb calorimeter, then I'm back to this just the same. Change in temperature for the reaction. Alright, so let's have a look at our example calculation for page 22. So I'll just grab some of this off here. And perhaps you can see also why it's important to keep the track of which change in temperature belongs to what. Seconds, some good things to watch. We've got a bomb calorimeter that is calibrated by passing 2 amps of current through the instrument for 410 seconds at a potential difference of 5 volts. And the temperature rises by, so delta T equals 0.820 degrees Celsius. Remember that our energy, H is equal to VIT. But we can also combine the two calculations together, but let's do it separately like it's done in the book. Must be in seconds. That's another area where you might find that it might be over 2 minutes or some other time, so you need to convert that back to seconds. So that's our entropy there. It's really our change in entropy because it was our change in time. So our calibration factor, which you can write as CF, is then equal to, and we want it in kilojoules, 4.10 kilojoules. divided by our change in temperature. We end up with 5 kilojoules per degree Celsius as our calibration factor. Now that we have determined the calibration factor, we can use this information for the reaction, the chemical reaction that's part B. In part B it says we've got a sample, 0.5030 grams of the rocket fuel hydrazine, N2H4. It's burned in the calorimeter. The temperature rises, so the change in temperature for this part of the reaction is going to equal 28.16 subtract 24.62, because we're given the starting and the final temperatures. So we want to, we just put it down to T. Determine the molar heat of combustion of hydrazine. Here we're going to use the, this gives us a change in temperature of 3.54 degrees. So we're just going to use our calibration factor to tell us, well, how much energy was involved when we burnt this hydrazine. So the heat of our reaction is equal to our calibration factor multiplied by the change in temperature of the reaction. And remember that we already converted this to kilojoules, and so our answer now is in kilojoules. But this was just for the quantity that we had in our body calorimeter. We're asked to determine the molar heat of combustion. So we're going to need to know how many moles did we have. So we know the sample mass is 0.5030. We need to know the molar mass for hydrazine. So maybe 2 times 48.01 plus 4 times 1.008. Which according to our booklet, that given it is 32. So when we burn this many moles of hydrazine, this is the amount of energy released. If you want to know how much energy will be released by burning 1 mole, so now the sample question is perhaps easier than some of those in the booklet and that you might start in a test or exam. Because everything's been separated out, we haven't been given all the information in one row. The information for the second part after the calibration is separate. So do need to make sure that you're attributing the correct changes in temperatures to the correct part of the question. So in the sense that there are a few places where you need to change the temperatures. But if you think it through what you're actually doing,
do the bond calorimeter.